Father, we give you praise. Settle peace with God. Make sure your heart is pure before Him. Ask Him to forgive whosoever has done you wrong, and ask Him to forgive you of your own wrongdoings. Let the blood purge and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Ask Him even by His mercy to visit everyone within and around you and the entire world at their point of need. O Lord, by your mercy we bring before you everyone in our world. Visit everyone, O God, at their point of need, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Holy Spirit, come. O bangatiti tidi yaba. Holy yatankra parute yami. Seleperai tenkle prokotia. Jesus, we give you all the glory.
Jesus, we give you the highest.
Hallelujah. Praise the living God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Father. Give Him thanks. Give Him all the glory. Give Him all the honor. Give Him all the adoration. Let's just begin to agree as we lift up everyone still to connect to the program. Ask the Lord by His mercy. He said no one comes to the Son, Jesus Christ, which means no one comes to any true servant of Christ except the Father draws him. Father, draw them that are still to connect to this program now, wherever they are. By your spirit and your angels, go, Lord, all over the world. Touch and draw everyone that you have ordained this blessing and this grace for today. Let no one be held back by the devil for any reason. Holy Spirit, Father, move. Father, even you on the throne and Father in manifestation, move by your angels. Touch and draw as many wherever they are. Help those who are forgotten. Remind them. Assist even by your angels those who are finding difficulty to connect. Pray that the Lord would draw others. He said we should share every good news. Let us begin to share. Even as you pray for those still to connect to do so, may you yourself extend and share to invite others in your contacts that you know that are supposed to be connected with this blessing. If you did not invite someone to connect to the program, even now you can do that by sending them a text and tell them God is doing something, that they are to be part of the blessing. One of the manifestations of love is not to eat alone. So if you come to benefit from spiritual food, you must desire always that many others partake of the same. By inviting them, praying, and calling them, even now you can do that if you did not do it. And even if you did, you can still do more. Father, we thank you. Let your spirit continue to draw them wherever they are and continue to bring them to receive of the fullness of your grace and truth that you have made available for us today. By your Holy Spirit, we welcome you, Father. Move in our midst again. Holy Spirit, touch, draw, help. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The background. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise the living God.
Hallelujah.
Again, you are welcome to today's Christ Disciples Fellowship. Let us proceed with this word of prayer in agreement. Eternal King of Glory, Lord God Almighty, we thank you for another opportunity to bless us again today by your word and by your spirit. We thank you for the blessings we received last program, even in the prophetic encounter morning. We thank you for the testimonies in our lives, and we return all praise and all glory and honor to you. And we ask you, Father, again, let through this program, everyone you have drawn to connect, let them receive a touch of your blessing and let them be blessed. Let those that need salvation receive, even in the course of the program. Let those that need healing or deliverance receive, even in the course of this program. Let there be the wisdom and the light of transformation. And let everyone, O God, be removed from the present state of ignorance to a new level of light. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Eternal Father, I submit and acknowledge to you that humanly I can do nothing. But I submit to you even that which you have given to me as the members of my body, particularly my heart, and through my mind and my brain and my lips, that you will manifest again and bless every one of your children. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Thank you, Father, for your mercy. I pray that you forgive us of all our wrongdoings and forgive even those who have done us wrong. Help us, Lord, to stand even before you now with pure hearts, that by your Spirit you will teach us, you will guide us into all truth, and you will even show and reveal to us what is to come. And let, O Lord, all glory and all praise and honor for what you have done in this program and what you are doing and what you will do be rendered unto you even now and forevermore. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Thank you, Father. Receive all the glory and honor. We have prayed even as we have agreed, in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Praise the living God.
Hallelujah.
Again, you are all welcome in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Today, we have an opportunity to interact if people have questions, particularly in respect to our last program, which is during the program of the prophetic encounter morning this Saturday morning. So you are free to ask questions to understand better. But you can ask questions in anything respect to the teachings and the lessons we have been having concerning foundational wisdom, as well as the teachings of Christ, even concerning prayer on Christ's prayer lessons. So you can ask any question within the framework of the teachings we have been having or the messages that you have from this throne or this altar. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
For the sake of time, we don't want to just go and be asking questions which are out of the context, because we have just 1 hour within this program. So let us see, as I read for us this word of scripture and we proceed. Our focus text for today is actually the text we used yesterday, which is Matthew chapter 13, precisely what we can read from verse 38 to 43. But for the sake of time, we'll be reading just some few portions, and then we get to ask questions. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
But before that Matthew is read, I want to read for us John chapter 14, verse 26. Our Lord Jesus speaking, he says, "But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things," number one. Number two, and "bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you." The Lord bless the reading of his holy word.
Thanks be to God.
So the Lord made us to know, he said, the helper, some versions say comforter, all still mean the same, but the application of helper here indicates our need of help. But one of the things is that somebody doesn't help generally just helping. He helps in specific things. And so the Lord went ahead to try to give us one of the major areas of the help. Among the help is that he would teach us. So he was saying that day before he was to go to the cross, he said, when the helper, but the helper, then he now said the Holy Spirit. So that if you do not know that is the Holy Spirit, he's talking about the Holy Spirit. Whom the Father will send. So now we could say, But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father has sent, and who is supposed dwelling in you if you are born again as a child of God. Among his many functions is primarily to teach us all, not some, all things, including not religious things limited, including things concerning your job, career, education, family, and any aspect. All means all. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
So we want to expose our heart in pure conscience to expect him to teach us, even though I stand here as his servant to coordinate. That is why we want to get some more understanding, and we will actually understand more during the question and answer session, which we're going to start very soon. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So the Holy Spirit dwelling in you as a child of God, and if it's not yet, means you are not born again, and you all need to sincerely from your heart believe and confess that Jesus is Lord and Lord of your life, and you mean it, and then he will dwell in you. And among his assignment is to teach. He speaks at least primarily by the witness, and the inner voice follows suit and every form. But the consciousness that he's a teacher is to teach. That already tells us our primary function in relating with God, coming to him in prayers or fellowship, worship, is to come more as a student. Because he, the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, is another called Areplak Parakletus, another kind of Christ. That because it shows that Jesus Christ was primarily a teacher. They call him Rabbi. Even though he was not within their religious, pharisaical, and the sect of their kind. But because most of his assignment was preoccupied with teaching, and follow suit preaching before performing the signs. And so that's why his followers, and which has always been the pattern, the followers of any person that comes with a master taught are called disciples. So the word disciples is another word for student in the Greek language. So Jesus was primarily teaching his followers, and when he left, the one that came just like him, taking his place, though now in the spirit, by relating with us, and we can experience him in his manifestation as more real, is also a master teacher. And now primarily as a spirit, he can teach anyone, anywhere, who believe in Christ and seek him to teach him or her. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So that is our understanding. And he's not only teaching, but he also reminds. So it's the same, like even especially when you are in the school in the exams, you forget to get the answers you have studied before the question. You can ask him even simple, quiet thoughts of meditation. And these are some of the things I captured in my book that is coming out very soon, Wisdom, Power to Excel in Exams and Business. So you will actually understand that the greatest advantage we have as children of God is the role of this Holy Spirit dwelling in us, living with us as the Father from the throne, to teach us, to give us divine education beyond just religious and secular speculation and mental suggestions. There are things you can never understand by trying to just read the scriptures and reason them. But you understand when you ask the master teacher, who is not only to teach but to guide into all truth. He will teach and tell us all we need to know. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So in respect to the main focus of the subject, which we now going to start having questions from, if you have, let us listen as that Matthew chapter 13 is read. From verse, just start from verse 36.
Then Jesus sent the multitude away and went into the house. And his disciples came to him, saying, "Explain to us the parable of the tares of the field." He answered and said to them, "He who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, the good seeds are the sons of the kingdom, but the tares are the sons of the wicked one. The enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are the angels. Therefore, as the tares are gathered and burnt in the fire, so it will be at the end of this age. The Son of Man will send out his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all things that offend and those who practice lawlessness, and will cast them into the furnace of fire. There will be wailing and gnashing of teeth. And the righteous will shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their Father. He who has ears to hear, let him hear."
Praise the Lord. The Lord bless the reading of his holy word.
Thanks be to God.
So I want to highlight just a few things there, and then you can now be free to ask your questions if you have. And if you don't have, I have questions for you. So we are more in a classroom approach, which is important for us in order to grow in the light or the knowledge of God. We can see here, and which is the main thing I want us to take, even if we forget so many things. As Christ himself interpreting the parable, which we know started from verse 24 of that Matthew chapter 13. And these are just few of the parables that he interpreted. A lot of his parables were not interpreted. So it means that there are aspects about the parable which are clearly explained by him in their interpretation. From the verse 37, which says, as he was interpreting, "He who sows the good seed," the seed, even from the parable before the interpretation, he said, "He who sowed the seed," not seeds. "He who sowed the seed," one seed. So I want you to take note of the fact that he sowed the seed, not seeds. And then you see in the verse 38, he said, "The field is the world, the good seeds." Now, he said, "He who sowed the seed is one he sowed." But now, that seed is now, which is the good, is now saying the good seeds, plurals, having to mean more than one. The seeds which are sown as the good seed by the Lord are many, at least more than one. And that's why I said the good seeds. But the description of the sowing or the planting by the Lord, which is the context of the parable, is described to that he planted but one seed. That question now is, what is the seed? Though the seeds here are in symbolic representation, means the sons or generally the children of God, those who the Lord brought. But the picture of the sowing shows that during the sowing, he sowed but one. And that would tell us that if the good seed, he sowed but one, but in the course of their manifestation are now more than one, then there is a clear understanding that the Lord sowed the seed he planted was able to multiply. That can give us a clue to find exactly which was that seed he planted. Because this parable is directly interpreted by Christ, giving us a clue of the picture of God sending people into the world. And then the devil also sending his own. So now he said that, so the good seeds are the children of the kingdom, which somebody leads to mean me and you, but the tares, like the other version we use, seeds or weed, or summary, bad seeds, are the children of the wicked one. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
The last thing there in the parable interpretation, which is verse 43, he said, then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their father. The one who has ears, let him hear. So where would they shine? Part of that was explained yesterday. Yes. Where would they shine? So these are some of the questions we must understand in detail. But also significantly in verse 40, he told us when the harvest is supposed to take place, the time. And that is one of the most important things you should not forget in anything that you need to learn about this interpretation of Christ's parable. As the wheats, which are the bad seeds, are collected and burned with fire, so it will be at the end of the age. That means they told us when that process of the harvest is supposed to take place. At the end of the age, that's how it will be. And what will be then? That the Lord will send his angels and they will gather the bad seeds. Like this version of New English Translation will use the word weeds. The bad seeds are the weeds, which is W-E-E-D-S. And the good seed is the supposed wheat, like W-H-E-A-T. So just giving a picture of the grain, because that's the exact material context of what you find in the botanical studies or reality. You have the wheat, which is, and then you have another kind of plant, which is wheat, that's W-E-E-T. And they sound to look similar in everything, and even in their grains. But until when real identification and mature differentiation is taking place, good seed, which is the wheat, from the bad one. So these things must be understood to really be established. The Bible says, get wisdom, but in all that you are getting, or in all you are getting, get understanding. Because if understanding, a house is built through wisdom, yes, but by understanding it's established. Whatever you apply, whatever you decide, when you don't have understanding, you will not really be firm in that decision. So understanding is key, and that's why the Lord said it is only those who receive the word and understand that bears fruit. So you can act because you are believing from what you are receiving. You believe by assumption, but you must grow from assumption to understand what you are believing, in order for your belief to be firm, because if not, it is going to be shaken. That's why many people believe today, they doubt tomorrow. Because after believing, they do not advance to understand the knowledge of what they believe. To understand, you must go into deeper analysis and reasoning and pondering and seeking from the master or the teacher to tell you what he really meant about what you are believing. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So now, I will get the floor open. If somebody has a question to ask, you know the main subject matter, and you have the teachings of yesterday, and then series of teachings in this area, you can ask your question. You can indicate with a hand sign so that if we are receiving the questions, we can follow that order. But even if you don't know how to indicate the hand sign, if you have a question, if you don't know how to operate the device, you can still speak out. Just make sure that you do not interrupt somebody when he's speaking. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So our session is based on questions and answers. And we have to try to show that we are studying, or else we are just following like people who doesn't know where they are going. Anything you truly learn from, you must always have questions to ask from that lesson, because you can never understand even 25% of any subject you are hearing for the first time, even maybe second or third time. What happens is that you discover things there that are interesting and which you need to understand better. So this is time for question. Please, you can go ahead with your question. If I wait for the next 5 minutes, I don't see any question, I'll pray and close us for today. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So I'm sure there's no question. I have a question. Yes, go ahead and ask your question, please. Okay. Tell us your name and from where you are connecting from and ask your question.
Okay. My name is Adailat Damu. I'm connecting from US. My question is about African woman, how they discipline their children. Because one day, the day you taught us concerning that lesson, I had this question in my mind. I want to ask Apostle that you said that when we should beat him, when the child feel pain, we ourselves.
Okay.
I want to ask, yes.
Yes, go ahead and ask.
But I want to ask in the situation of these children that we are raising now, that they are just too stubborn. When we talk, they don't hear.
Okay, for the sake of time, I already understand the question. That question, first of all, is not within the context of what we are looking at today, so we don't have time to really go after it. But that's still okay. What I will do is that I will need to get to talk with you to really answer that question for you to understand. But this is the point. Since you have asked it, let me just make it so that it doesn't be like I just throw the question. Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Do you believe what he said?
Yes.
That's it. Answer. Do whatever he said. Forget about any excuse you can give. Your God cannot ask you to do what he knows you cannot do. If it has to do that, then he's a liar. And God, the Bible says, cannot lie. So we are even the ones who are stubborn than those children. That's the reason why we find it difficult to do what he's saying. It's our own stubbornness that we are trying to justify the excuses to them. Anything God tells anybody to do, before he says it, is because he has already empowered the person to be able to do it. So, just for the fact that it's instruction that the Lord gave, what we have to know and do, and even part of what we are learning, is the fact that anytime you have an instruction, you want to find out what did the Lord Jesus say. If this is what Jesus has approved or confirmed or said directly, then I have no option. What I have to do is to go and ask for the grace to do it. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Now, it also means that there is the grace which he says is sufficient. 2 Corinthians 12:9. Grace means God's ability, enablement, help, God's intervention to help us in affairs of what we need to do on earth according to his will. So the reason why he's even called a helper by the Spirit now, what did I say last time? It means that somebody is there to help you. So anything you find God says we should do that you cannot do, it means that it is an indication that there is a helper you should contact. If not, they won't give you a helper if what they are expecting you to do, you can do it by yourself. So for now, that's just part of what, but In a more particular detail about that, I will find time to talk to you and give you more specifics on this particular case you are seeing. But just have, everybody should just have in mind that the only way for us to escape the troubles of this world is to know that no human mortal being is wiser than his God. And Jesus Christ is the manifestation of God, who is our creator. So he is the final of the truth and the final of the one that loves us. So whatever he told or tell us to do, wisdom demands that we should do it, because he knows better why he's asking us to do it. But the product, the end product to it, is that everything God tells us to do is for our good. If we don't do it, we are the one to suffer. If we do it, we are the one to benefit. So I pray, may the Lord give us grace to understand why he appoints himself by the Spirit as a helper to help us do everything he instructs us. And so any parent that is there, and anybody anywhere struggling to think that the way of correction is still the Old Testament method, may the Lord grant you grace to be delivered from that now, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Any other question? There is no other question. All right. If there's no other question, I'm going to ask a question, and then after that I pray. Those who are on this program, are there people here who follow up this program yesterday, or who have listened to that message? Okay. So I'm sure this subject and this is relative to what we did yesterday, or what we learned yesterday, right? That's the focus of the subject, is exactly what we learned yesterday. But I said that even if you have questions relative to the teachings of Christ that we have been learning, you can ask. Praise the Lord. So now, there is a very insensitive aspect here which we must understand that is relating to this subject. It says in that verse 40, therefore, as the tares, which is the bad seeds, are gathered and burned in the fire, so it will be at the end of this age. So the description of the application of when the bad seeds have to be uprooted is the end of this age. Now, I ask the question, what is the time for that harvest? We already know, generally I said, now we are in the time, but with the specification of the word, the age, some version use age, some versions use the end of the world, some use the closure of the world. Because this part has to help us understand a lot about the dichotomy of the supposed rapture message. This age. Now the King James used this age. Some version will say the age, at the end of the age. But both the original King James and the New King James use this. And so, which means that if look at it, and the context of King James is what we have to take here, shows that he was referring to the age he was in. That age also there means era. So the question is, when is actually that age? When is the end of that age? If anybody has anything to answer to that question, you can speak out or respond. When is the end of the age, or this age is talking about? Yes, anybody who has whatever you have, anybody, anybody can have something. Okay, so now in calculation, what will be the time? Because eventually, that way, which is what most of us have, is true. But when? Is it 10 years' time, 2 years' time, or has it passed already? Or not at all?
No one knows the time. Is it time that we know, or is it time that we don't know? We just look forward to the time based on what the Word of God is saying.
So, but Christ said, this age, which is this era. So, if you say this, means you are identifying something that is definite. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So, the age means era, which also we can say dispensation. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So what Christ was saying there, we could say it will be at this dispensation. Now, like the response that I already got from you people, what did he say is supposed to happen with that age or this age? If you are following with me, you should be good students. Read verse 41. Because in verse 40, he's telling us, he said, in verse 40, that's where he said, as therefore the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so shall it be in the end of this world. The old King James used this world. The new King James used this age. Which all that would give you a clear, is talking about the end. So the end of this world, which is what we call the end time. Is that clear?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
So the end of this world or this age, the specification this, it means it's definite. But what will happen? He said that is what will be as this takes place, so shall it be in the end of this world or the end of this age. What will be? Verse 41. The Son of Man shall send forth his angels, and they shall gather out of his kingdom all things that offend and them which do iniquity. So, and we know, you read that conclusively, verse 43 tells you that until that happens, the sons of God, the sons of righteousness, which is supposed to be me and you, will not shine. So now, we don't know the time. That tells you that we will never ever be in dominion or control. Because that parable tells us until that process has taken place, which will only happen at the end of this age, Christ saying, or the end of this world, or the end of the world, or you call it the end of that era. He said when that end, that time comes, that's now when he will send his angels for them to remove these bad seeds. And when the bad seeds have been removed as prescribed, then the verse 43, then shall the righteous, which means the sons, the good seeds, the children of God, you and me, suppose, will now shine as the sun in the kingdom of their father, which is actually in this world. So, which means that we now will never succeed until that has happened. We can never be in rulership, or we cannot control, we cannot be in dominion, we can't fulfill, we can't shine. Just like when you say, if the sun is supposed to shine and it can't shine, means you can't function. For you to function, what he said has to be done in verse 41 has to be done. But he told us, when will he do what will be done in verse 41? It's at the end of this age. So if that end of that age for someone is 100 years time, then that 100 years time will be when the sons of righteousness, the children of God, will shine. And if that end of this age for someone is in forever not knowing, then forever not knowing, the son of righteousness will never shine. How would God be so funny to do something like that? Why will he send his righteous ones on earth and with the agenda for them to advance the cause of righteousness to shine? Why will he create sun with the intention for the sun to shine and the sun will never ever shine? Does that make any sense? So we need to upgrade our mind really far if we must catch up with the devil and the sons of the wicked in their operation in this world. Because they are very smart in most of these things that we are still grappling around. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So that which must happen is what Christ said. And that's why I said, first thing is to first of all ask ourselves the question, do I believe in Christ? If I say yes, the next question is, do I believe his word? If I say yes, the next question is, what's the evidence? How much of his word that he has said what I should do and I'm not doing? Or how much of his word he has said what I should do and I'm doing? And if I'm not sure of his word, because sometimes that's where the issue is. Okay, but this one also is in the Bible, but this one is this and this. If I'm not sure that what Christ says is final, then let me check the many things that he said while he was on earth, and they happen exactly so. That would now tell us that every other thing he said must happen so. For example, he said, in a little while you will see me no more. And then just in a little while you will see me. Did that happen or not? In a little while they saw him no more for 3 days. Was that true? Yes. And then 3 days after they saw him again. He said that happened. He said what will happen and it happened. Does that not tell us that anything he tells us that will happen must happen? So we must understand that if the Lord says something must happen, and he said it will happen at the end of this age, or you call it this world, of this world there is the language that we have as what we call end time. And he used the word this while he was on earth. That means that this that he's defining includes the age involving him while he was on earth. So we now have to go further to research if we want to know more. This age, that is the age he was on earth, which means era, or what you call the end. But in a global summary, it also means dispensation. In the picture of God, there are three major dispensations of operation. The dispensation of the Father, which is the shadow introduction. The dispensation of the Son, which is the basic and the base dispensation. And the dispensation of the Holy Spirit. That's why you say Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. So in terms of the age as dispensation, it was talking about the end of his own dispensation. Which means that the that situation, that which he has said will happen, supposed to start happen at the end of his own dispensation. And that end of his own dispensation is the beginning of the other dispensation. Is that clear for somebody to say amen?
Amen.
What does that simply mean? This one is just a summary aspect of it, which can make sense for us religiously, but it will still be difficult for many people to understand. The end of this his dispensation as the Lord God in the physical, the Son. That means the end of the dispensation of the Son, this dispensation of the Son of God. The next dispensation that will start is the dispensation of the Holy Spirit. That means by that clue tells you that what he said will happen, supposed to begin immediately the dispensation of the Holy Spirit starts. Does that make sense now to know the time? And the meaning to this are a lot there. First of all, he said what we read. He's talking about harvest. The harvest to the kingdom starts when? When the Holy Spirit came. Nobody can be saved when the Holy Spirit has not come. Is that not true? So looking at it, he's talking about harvest. So they have to harvest to the kingdom, when is it supposed to start? Is it not when the Holy Spirit comes? Does that not give you a clue? Because that's what he's saying that will start. The harvest will start, which goes alongside of rooting the bad plants. Is that true? So at least in the religious perspective, know that this process is activated to have commenced the very day Peter stood after the Holy Ghost came, which was now present on earth. And we are postponing what has already supposed to be in effect from 2000 and something years ago. And we are still waiting for the days ahead. And some of us will never even know when. So how do we even engage to be part of what they said will happen? We can't even do our part. So may the Lord help us to learn from what we have understood, that the dispensation in terms of this age, which could mean era, which could mean the end of the world, the next dispensation began with the coming of the Holy Spirit. But that is on the generic perspective. Now this means that starting point has its climax. In everything, you have the starting and the ending. And if, now, to show that relates with, they say, the end of the world, which is what we call the end time, right? Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
So, looking even in that context, when did the end? When is the end time? When will the world end? Some of us, we are still looking, something we will never know. Now, let's hear what Peter said. On the day the same Holy Spirit comes, to prove that the dispensation of the era is talking started with the dispensation of the coming of the Holy Spirit. On the day the Holy Spirit came to the earth, that is the new dispensation, which is the end of the old dispensation. That's the end of that world. That new dispensation started with the coming of the Holy Spirit. Peter told us why he was preaching after the Holy Ghost came. He said, when they said the people were drunk, he said, no, these are not drunk as you suppose. But certainly they are drunk with something, which is this time not the substance. He said, it is that which was spoken by the prophet who? Joel. That what? That in the what? Last days, which is your end time. Right? He said that which was prophesied by Joel that will happen or begin when? In the last days, or the end of the age, or the end of the world, or the end time. Peter said 2000 and something years ago when the Holy Ghost came, he said that is what is happening then is that which was said was going to happen. So then do we now see where the last day started? So Joel prophesied it. So what now is the meaning of that starting of the last days? Is it not the beginning of the dispensation of the Holy Spirit? That's why, for example, Christ said, if you believe in me, you will do what I did, and even greater. And he said, the reason for, because I'm going to the Father. What is the meaning to that? Because in John 16, you hear him said, it is important for me to go, meaning to go to the Father, because if I do not go to the Father, what will happen? I will not send. The Comforter will not come. The Holy Spirit will not come. Did you see that? Amen?
Amen.
So he's now saying that you can do what he did because he's going to who? The Father. Why? Because if he goes to the Father, then he can now send the promise of the Father, who is who? The Holy Spirit. Which means he's saying we can do what he did and even greater when the day of the Holy Spirit begins. When he has sent the Holy Spirit. Now that means that end of his dispensation, he was referring to this. So these sons of the wicked, suppose, and the action suppose commence from the end of this age, of Christ's age, beginning from the end of the Holy Spirit age. So 2,000 and something years, that agenda of God has been activated, but now, as years goes by, it's supposed to be more actively in effect. The problem is, whatever God promised and say he would do, whatever he prophesied, as long as he has to do with the earth, there is a part of man. And that part of man can make what God expects to happen, because Peter was always saying, this is that which was prophesied by Joel, that in the last days, or at the end, in the end time. And Peter said, this is it that has begun. If many of us here are still waiting for it some days, imagine them in that day. Can they believe that that is it that has started? We are 2,000 and something years plus. We have read through this many things. We are still looking for some last day. Then imagine them that day that Peter is speaking. It was just 50 days ago, when the complete dispensation alluded, when the Holy Spirit went 40 days of Christ on earth, 10 days after he left for the Holy Spirit to come. And now there are just 50 days. Peter said, this is that last day that has begun. We are 2,000 and something years. We are still looking for some another 5,000 years for it. Then people who were just experiencing the beginning of that, you can see all these things are the things that tells us that we have a long way to go if we will really manifest as the sons of God. Because we hear that promise there in that parable. There are two kinds, the sons of the wicked and the sons of who? And the sons of the kingdom cannot shine except the sons of the wicked are doing what? Rooted out. That rooted out now is another question. What does that mean? All these things have both the beginning literal part of it. They have the spiritual part, which has many layers to be opened. And those are not things even in 1 year class lesson that can be exhausted in teaching. So I just have to help us have a clue that there's so much we have to learn if we must really go far. And so much of knowledge requires reattention and focus. So there are certain things we can't just do within 1 hour and few minutes of a program. But the Holy Spirit, from the first scripture I read, his assignment is to teach. Why would they be paying somebody as a teacher if there was not huge assignment for him to teach students? Does that make sense? So, the end of the age, that's the first part of it. But then there is even the cosmological meaning of the end of the age, which he referred to this age. That one I can give you exactly the calculation according to the cosmos and zoological calculations, which time. That one, the age era there has to do also with what they call how do they call this? I don't know whether it's century. No, it's not century. Like when they talk about the lifetime of people, generation. That what he said there, this age means also this generation. The aspect of generation, we have so many different calculations, some few cases in the Bible. There's a generation calculated at 40 years span. There's a generation calculated as 100 years. Those ones are recorded in scripture. But there is the generation calculation with sociological verdicts, which is relating to the universal programming of the universal calculation. That means that one is calculated by what is called the sun rotating. I mean the sun evolving and the earth rotating. That's why if something is rotating, you see that every year, they say the year must start at January, right? It is not somebody that stood and took a pen. They can put names there. But what that means is that our calculation is the time the earth goes round the sun. When the rotation has completed, like now you have, they calculated that it's 24 hours. So 12 hours of that your day is supposed to be night. 12 hours is supposed to be what? Light, right? Or sun. So the time, the name they put there doesn't matter. But the period calculation is the fact that the sun, the earth must have gone round, like if you are rotating a ball or something in the center. Point A, starting point, it has come back to the starting point. So that is what determines now the different phases of what you have, about how many period or hours, they call it hours, but the period is calculated based on how much the rotation goes through in a day. So whether you like it or not, you are just sitting here on earth. You see yourself like you are sitting on a certain surface, substance that is stable, but you know that the Bible says, even the Bible acknowledged that, and science proved it, that it's rotating, right? Though you are not seeing it like it's rotating, and it's going around. So whether you like it or not, when it has crossed the path portion for the sun, it starts going the other side. You start having darkness, whether you like it or not. Is that true?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So that process also is what determines the month. That's why you have in the book of Revelation talking about 12 fruits, 12 months. That process now gives the seasons. And that process now goes to its final climax of what culminates a generation. And the final calculation of the cosmological verdict of a generation is what culminates about God's calculation of the entering of God from his heavens of heavens to the earth. All these ones are not at your level to enter there now. But let us try and learn the one that we're supposed to know. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So Christ has told us that was supposed to start in the end of his dispensation. Or in terms of dispensation, it means it begins when the dispensation ends, another one starts. In terms of the end time, it means when a time, whatever you call, whether it's the end time, the close of the age, or whatever how Peter called it, or prophesied by Joel, it means when one's end, another one starts. There is no such end as some day something end, and then another is not starting. It doesn't exist. If the night is ending now, it means that the day is start breaking, right? If the day is ending now, what happened? So that's what we should see. Now, it means that we have to now look at how does this apply in our context. Like Peter now was saying that day, he said, this is that which was prophesied that what? In the what? Last days. Which means the last day started from that day we call Pentecost, or the Holy Pentecost, as I call it, because they have already been celebrating Pentecost. That one was the one that started with the Holy Spirit. So now, we are 2,000 and plus something years in the last days, and we are still talking about some end time, waiting for some kind of things. When the Son has already gone, and send the Holy Spirit.